Well, good morning, church. This is a day that the Lord has made, and we are a people that God has made, and God has called everything God has made. Good, wonderful. If you're worshiping with us online, if you are worshiping with us for the first time, if you're a regular worshiper with us at Fenton United Methodist Church, welcome. We're so glad you're here. Thank you for choosing to worship God with Fenton United Methodist Church out of all the other fine churches in our communities and online. And if you're with us in the sanctuary this morning, I invite you to stand right where you are, do a 360 and wave to those people who are looking at you. And for those who are worshiping with us on Facebook, I hope you will say good morning on your feed. Excellent. I want to remind you that as far as singing goes, we are still, and first of all, hey, I'm really so grateful to see all of your eyes here today. I'm sure there are smiles under the masks. And I appreciate so many, everyone that I'm seeing right now is wearing a mask, and I deeply appreciate that. And I know that the folks who are concerned about, you know, this is maybe their first time coming to this place to worship this morning, are concerned about, well, is everybody wearing masks and is everybody distancing? And I'm glad and excited to say, yeah, absolutely. Back to singing. For our singing this morning, we're back to singing at a speaking volume. So I want to remind you about that. And of course, the lyrics to the hymns are printed in your bulletin. This morning, we continue our series called God Came to Me. And we're looking at folks in the Bible for whom the gospel was, not related necessarily to Jesus and the cross, but that God came to these individuals and it did something amazing in their lives. And this morning, we're talking about briefly about the life and the death of Moses. And the Bible says over and over again how God and Moses met face to face. And I don't know what that looked like for Moses and for God, but for you and I think that looks a lot like prayer and a lot like worship. And so this morning, as we meet with God face to face, as Moses' life was transformed and changed, and God's glory and radiance just beamed out of him, I pray that we will go from this place with God's radiance and glory beaming from us, and that we will be changed, be more like Christ, because we've been here and we've been in worship. So let's begin our worship. Matt will sing some music for centering, and then Vicki will invite us to worship.
None of us knows, and this makes it a mystery. If life is a comedy, then why all this tragedy? 3.5 pounds of brain try to figure out what this world is all about, and is there an eternity? Is there an eternity? God, if you're there, I wish you'd show me. And God, if you care, then I need you to know me. I hope you don't mind me asking the questions, but I figure you're big enough. I figure you're big enough. Lying on pillows, we're haunted and half awake. Does anyone hear us pray? If I die before I wake, then the morning comes and the mirror's another place where we wrestle face to face with the image of deity. The image of deity. God, if you're there, I wish you'd show me. And God, if you care, then I need you to know me. I hope you don't mind me asking the questions, but I figure you're big enough. I figure you're big enough. When I imagine the size of the universe, and I wonder what's out past the edges, then I discover inside me a space is big, and believe that I'm meant to be filled up with more than just questions. So God, if you're there, I wish you'd show me. And God, if you care, then I need you to know me. I hope you don't mind me asking the questions, but I figure you're big enough. I figure you're big enough, 'cause I am not big enough.
The grace of God be with you, and also with you. We have come to meet with God, to worship God and to praise Him. God has invited us to meet face to face, so we come to bring our whole selves to God. May God's grace transform us. May God be blessed by our love and gratitude. Let us pray. As we look back over the landscape of our lives, O Lord, we recognize the places where your grace has sustained us, carried us, comforted us, guided and protected us. Most of all, we see that you have been present with us always, on the mountaintops of joy, in the valleys of sorrow, and on the plains of the mundane. Thank you, O God, for walking with us every step of the way. Receive our worship, our thanks, and our praise as our heartfelt response for your great love in our lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I see. And now, if you'll remain standing and join with me in our affirmation of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, and the third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge in the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. One of my favorite authors is Father Henry Nouwen. And on the subject of prayer, Father Nouwen writes, to live is to pray. He writes, to pray is to live. To pray is to live. And I think there's a great deal of truth to that. But as I filter it through other things that I've read and other things that I believe and other things that I just hold as truth, I think it is also true that to live is to pray, or to pray is, yeah, to live is to pray. And what I mean by that is I remember reading a book by a guy named Brother Lawrence, who wrote this, well, it wasn't intended as a book, but it became a book. He was a monk in, I'm going to say, the 16th century. And he wrote a book called Practicing the Presence of God. And he wrote about, as a monk, he was in charge of the kitchen, the scullery, really, to wash the dishes. And he made washing dishes into a prayer. And he made mopping the floor into a prayer. And from other books I've read by not only Father Nouwen, but Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel and Frederick Buechner talk about how the tears of a broken heart are a prayer, yeah? And so are the tears of joy. The sigh at the end of a hard day of work is a prayer. And the sigh at yet another, listen to another bit of bad news is a prayer. You know, when is it going to end? That's prayer, right? And so I've come to decide that to live is to pray, and that everything that we do in some realm, prayer. And so as we go to prayer this morning, we come to prayer to God, who is with us in those mountaintops and with us in those valleys and with us in those plains of the mundane, where in all of those places, it is prayer, and God hears our prayers, whether we pause and bow our heads and close our eyes and fold our hands, or we're on the road going, oh my gosh, right? So let's take these moments of worship where we offer ourselves and our daily lives to God in prayer. And I'm just going to ask you just for a moment to close your eyes and to take a breath, and inhale and exhale, of course, and just become aware that God is present with you right now, wherever you are, and that God is sanctifying these moments, for these are truly sacred moments. We give you thanks, O God, that each moment is sacred, because you have sanctified time and you have sanctified our lives. And we make this space in worship and in our lives to become aware of your presence and to offer ourselves to you, our whole selves, our work and our leisure, our shopping and our working out, the tasks that we do at home, whether cooking or cleaning, watching television or reading, praying or reading the scripture or listening to music, eating our meals, interacting with family and neighbors and friends. We offer these moments to you and pray, O God, that in these sacred moments, we would not only allow you to do some amazing stuff in us, but through us, and allow us to be aware of your presence and activity in our lives and in the lives of others, and in the in this country and in this world more and more. For that is part and parcel of the power of prayer, that the more we do it, the more aware we are of your presence and activity. And so as we think about the landscape of our week that has been, we offer to you the whole of the week. We offer to you those places where we have succeeded and have been faithful, and we offer to you those places where we failed miserably, where our thoughts have not been helpful, where our attitudes have not been uplifting, where our actions have been hurtful. And as we look over the landscape of the week that is yet to come and anticipate what we think is coming, we offer those things to you, whether they are meetings or times of work and labor, times of rest, times of gathering, times of grief, times of concern. We offer it all to you and pray, O God, that in this brand new week that is yet to be, full of potential and promise, we pray for the awareness of your presence and activity in us, through us, and around us. And now, O God, in these sacred moments, hear our prayers as we pray silently, those things that are on our heart and in our mind. O Lord, the chaos and confusion that we often feel in our hearts may be a reflection of the chaos and confusion that we see around us every day, and especially in the news. We pray, O God, for peace in this country and around the world and in our hearts. And as you fill us with your peace, may we bear that peace to our neighbors, to our community. And as you fill us with your joy, may we bear your joy to our neighbors and our community. As you fill us with your hope and your love, O Lord, let us pour out upon others that with which you have filled us. For we pray it in the name of the one that you sent to be our Savior, your only Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. And in his name we pray the prayer that he taught his church to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The ship's been battered, the anchor holds, though the sail's been torn. I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging sea. The anchor holds in spite of the storm.
I've had visions, I've had dreams, I've even held them in my hand. But I never knew they would slip right through, like they were only grains of sand. The anchor holds, though the ship is battered. The anchor holds, though the sails are torn. I have fallen on my knees as I face raging seas. The anchor holds in spite of the storm.
I have been young, but I'm older now, and there has been beauty seen. But it was in the night storms of my life. Oh, that's where God proved his love to me. But the anchor holds, though the ship's been battered.
The anchor holds, though the sails are torn.
I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging seas, but the anchor holds in spite of the storm. I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging seas, but the anchor holds spite of the storm.
Ricky and Matt, thank you. Ricky, your face smiles while you sing. Today's scripture is Deuteronomy chapter 34, verses 1 through 10. Then Moses went up from the plains of Moab to Mount Nebo, to the top of Pisgah, which is opposite Jericho. And the Lord showed him the whole land, Gilead as far as Dan, all of Naphtali, and the land of Ephraim and Manasseh, all of the land of Judah as far as the western sea, the Negev and the plain, that is the valley of Jericho, the city of palm trees, as far as Zoar. The Lord said to him, "This is my land of which I swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, saying, I will give it to your descendants. I have let you see it with your eyes, but you shall not cross over there." Then Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab at the Lord's command. He was buried in a valley in the land of Moab, opposite Beth Peor, but no one knows his burial place to this day. Moses was 120 years old when he died. His sight was unimpaired and his vigor had not abated. The Israelites wept for Moses in the plains of Moab 30 days. Then the period of mourning for Moses was ended. Joshua, son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom because Moses had laid his hands upon him, and the Israelites obeyed him, doing as the Lord had commanded Moses. Never since has there arisen a prophet in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Vicki, nice job reading all those tarred words there. All right. Well done. You can clap, sure, why not? When I was at beautiful Wayne State University, I had the wonderful opportunity to study Western European communications. That was my bachelor's, was in broadcasting, and I got to study at University of London for the better part of a summer. I think it was like around 1985. And along with radio and television, we studied a lot of other communication things, especially movies as well. And I learned for the first time that there was a big difference between Hollywood-made movies and European-made movies. As we all are aware, typically Hollywood movies tend to have happy endings, right? The hero gets the girl, the good guy finishes first, the lovers live happily ever after. But in European movies, the good guy often loses, and the bad guy often gets the girl, and lovers sometimes die alone. It happens. Life seldom gives us Hollywood endings. And the same is true with Scripture. Take Moses, for instance. Here's a guy whom Judaism, Christianity, and Islam all lift up as a hero of the faith. But his is no Hollywood ending. You might remember that Moses' story begins in Egypt, but I want to pick it up several decades later when Moses is 80 years old. He's been married for the better part of 40 years and is working as a shepherd for his father-in-law. And he's out grazing the flocks in the wilderness, and he spots a bush that seems to be on fire but isn't burning up. Now, this is curious. So Moses steps a bit closer to get a better look at this phenomenon, and that's when Moses encounters God for the first time. And God calls on Moses to go back to Egypt and free the Israelites from slavery and bring them to the promised land, a land rich with resources. Now Moses is 80 years old, and he's thinking about retiring to Florida, say, or Arizona, to play canasta and sip on Moscow mules. Or maybe he and Mrs. Moses will retire to someplace a bit more temperate because they're tired of the desert. So Moses has been checking out brochures on Traverse City, right? The last thing Moses wanted to do was go back to Egypt, because back in Egypt there was still a wanted poster with his name on it. Moses even gave God a bunch of excuses why he should not be considered as a candidate for the job. But God doesn't take no for an answer, and Moses packs up and heads south to Egypt, picks up his brother Aaron along the way, and somewhere along the line they are joined by Moses' sister Miriam. I want to fast forward a bit, because we know that Pharaoh wasn't too excited to see Moses, much less let the Israelites go free, and Moses had a lot of headaches with the Pharaoh. At last, when Pharaoh lets the Israelites go and they finally escape the Egyptians, well, that's when the real headaches begin, don't they? People are complaining about not enough food and not enough water, and who is this God anyway who would take us from 3 square meals in Egypt to the desert where we're going to starve to death? And then, of course, there's the daily dose of, are we there yet? And then comes the moment when the people arrive at the borders of the promised land. And so they send out spies, 12 spies, to check out things out. And two of the spies come back and they say, we've got this. Or really, God's got this. But then the other 10 spies come back and say, we are all going to die. Right? So now they wander in the wilderness for 40 more years, blaming Moses for this and that and the other thing. They build a temple that can travel with them. It's called the tabernacle, where Moses can meet with God and where people can bring their offerings to God, and they can worship God and pray and have potluck suppers and trustees meetings. And through all this, Moses is faithful to God. And he wrote down everything that God told him, and he gave it to the Israelites verbatim. When he and God met in that mobile temple, the Bible says they met face to face, which is to say that they met as best friends. Moses and God were so tight that after meeting with God, Moses' face was so radiant with joy, or radiant with the reflection of God's glory, that people had to cover their eyes, right, to look Moses in the face. And they eventually asked Moses to wear a veil over his face because the light was so blinding. Can you imagine? There was even at this time a low point for Moses when God agreed to meet with Moses on the side of a mountain and walk past Moses in the fullness of God's glory. And just so Moses wouldn't die, God used his own hand to cover Moses' face while the fullness of God came this close to Moses. So Moses and God were best friends. And Moses did what God said, even if that meant he would get an earful from the Israelites or from his brother and sister. But then there was this one time, this one little time, this one teeny little time. You see, the people were complaining about wanting more water. And so Moses goes to God about that, and God says, no problem. bring the leaders of the people to this certain rock and command the rock to give you water, and the rock will open up and gush out water. Really great water. The best water, really. Ask anybody. Everybody's saying this is the best water, right? So Moses takes the people, or the leaders of the people, to that rock, but instead of commanding the rock to give water, Moses hits the rock with his staff, and the rock splits and out gushes water. But that act disqualifies Moses from entering into the promised land. At least that's what God decides. Now, the rabbis have all kinds of explanations for why the punishment seems really disproportionate to the crime, mainly having to do with more with the optics of it all, that the miracle of making water come out of the rock, the people might think, well, Moses did that with his staff instead of God doing that. Still, it seems a bit harsh. If this were a Hollywood movie, this is where the dramatic tension comes in. And we might console ourselves at thinking, you know, in Hollywood, Moses would cross over to the promised land anyway, and God would let that happen, and they would kiss and make up, and da-da-da-da-da-da, and Moses would walk into the promised land, and he would go into retirement with Mrs. Moses and play canasta and sip on Moscow mules and bounce their grandchildren on their knees. But this isn't a Hollywood movie. This is the Bible. And Moses' story has a very different ending. So as the children of Israel, after 40 years, stand once again on the borders of the promised land, God and Moses take one last walk up a mountain. And at the top, God reveals to Moses the place he had promised to Abraham and all of Moses' ancestors. The place that God described to Moses when they first met at the burning bush. Now, some rabbis believe that God even let Moses get a glimpse of the future of his people, the temple, and the prosperity of the people, and grandfathers bouncing their grandchildren on their knees. Now, what happens next, according to our English translation, is that Moses dies at the command of the Lord. But the Hebrew is so much more poetic and beautiful. The Hebrew reads more like this. God kissed Moses, and Moses died, and God himself buried Moses. I guess it is sort of a Hollywood ending. Moses doesn't get to retire to the promised land, but maybe he got something way better. All along the way, in the good times and the rough times, in the mountaintops and in the valleys, Moses met with God face to face. Things didn't always go as planned, but God was always there for Moses. Sometimes they argued. Sometimes they laughed until their sides ached. And sometimes they stayed up at night sharing their most inward thoughts and feelings face to face. And in the end, when it came Moses' time, God bent down and kissed him on the cheek. And maybe that was more than Moses expected, or maybe that's exactly what he had hoped, to have his best friend kiss him goodbye. And maybe that meant more to Moses than retiring to Canaan. The gospel for Moses is that God came to him, not just once, but nearly every day over the last half of his life. In the ups and downs, in the best and the worst, God came to him. God came to him and they met face to face and became the best of friends, the kind of friends that we all look for and that we all want to be in our best moments. And in the end, God kissed Moses to heaven. The gospel for Moses is the gospel for us today as well. Each and every day, Each and every day, no matter what the circumstances, when things are going our way and when they're not, when we obey God to the letter and when we fail miserably, when the world makes sense and especially when it doesn't, when the ending of one chapter of our life is not anywhere near a Hollywood ending and the next chapter feels like we're caught in between Godzilla and Darth Vader, God comes to us in this mobile temple we call prayer. God is faithful. God is with us. Things might not go as we hope or expect or dream, but the gospel is always, day after day after day, God comes to us in Jesus Christ and longs to meet with us face to face. Let's pray. Oh Lord, in our better moments, we long to meet with you face to face as Moses did. Let today be a beginning of meeting with you face to face and change our lives until that day when you kiss us into heaven. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Take time to be holy, speak oft with thy Lord, abide in him always, and feed on his word. Make friends of God's children, help those who are weak, forgetting in nothing his blessing to seek. Take time to be holy, the world rushes on. Spend much time in secret with Jesus alone. By looking to Jesus, like him thou shalt be. Thy friends in thy conduct his likeness shall see. Take time to be holy, let him be thy guide, and run not before him, whatever betide, in joy or in sorrow, still follow the Lord, and looking to Jesus, still trust in his word. Take time to be holy, be calm in thy soul. Each thought and each motive beneath his control. Thus led by his Spirit to fountains of love, thou soon shalt be fitted for service above.
Will you please remain standing and join with me in our prayer of commitment printed in our bulletin? Let's unite our hearts and voices as we pray. Forgive us, Lord, for while we know that you are always with us, always inviting us to fellowship with you, we often choose not to communicate with you in prayer, worship, or study. We rest on a faith we have not nurtured for weeks, months, or years. All the while, you have patiently waited for us to meet with you face to face. Help us, gracious God, to commit to meeting with you every day, and to reflect your grace in our lives every night. Thus may our lives glow with your radiance and love, to the glory of your name. Amen. Thank you, Gary. Before we go, Juana, I'm excited to tell you we're going to do Vacation Bible School this year. It will be virtual Vacation Bible School, right? So it's going to be online. And Kate and Carrie, Kate Glass and our children's ministry person, Carrie, my wife, who works with her in leadership on Vacation Bible School, it's really great. So the parents will pick up a packet, I think the week before, and there's a time online, something like 10 to 10:30 in the morning. And then the kids do the packet, and the parents work with them on the packet through the week. So this is August 17th to the 21st, and you can register on our website online. For those of you who are worshiping with us in person, would love for you to, as you leave today, put your offering and your Connect card in the offering basket. If you're worshiping with us online and you want to continue to give to God through Fenton United Methodist Church, we invite you to do that electronically. You can go to our website and hit that, or there's a button on our homepage about giving, and you can do it that way. Or there's several other ways, and you can contact the church office if you need to find another way to give electronically. I want to remind you, the ushers will be dismissing you from the back to the front, so please wait for the ushers to dismiss your row. But for now, if you are able, will you stand for these words of benediction and blessing? Beloved of Christ, may you go from this place renewed and transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit, more in love with God and more ready to meet with God face to face each and every day in every sacred moment. Go in peace. Amen. Amen. We'll see you next week. God loves you. I'll be here if you need me. I'll be right up here.